Welcome, everyone, to our Historic Crime Club. My name is Julia, and I work with the Newfoundland and Labrador Public Libraries. I have a great love of mysteries and a curiosity for history. The Historic Crime Club is a quarterly program where we choose a historic crime from Newfoundland and Labrador's past. Today, we'll be discussing the murder of William Keane in 1754. Pictured is actually Hugh Bonfoy, Newfoundland's governor at the time of the murder. I found no portraits of William Keane, so thought this would be a good illustration of a man from that time frame. In William Keane's time, St. John's was a rough and unruly place. Before he was made magistrate in 1750, the only law and order in Newfoundland were the fishing admirals, who kept the peace only during the fishing season and not for capital crimes. Court proceedings for capital crimes like murder or treason had to be held in England. After fishing season, there was virtually no law at all. There are very few records of Keane's left to this day. Keane sent this report to England about the French capture of St. John's in 1708, when he was just in his 20s. December 21st, 1708. About 4 this morning, we were alarmed by the firing of several muskets and were with half an hour's time reprised to hear the fort was taken without making resistance. Some small time after, the fort surrendered, the castle took the alarm and fired 2 cannon. All the inhabitants of that side, being about 60 men, were retired to the castle. About 7 this morning, 2 French officers came to assure the inhabitants of good quarters and took with them the most master inhabitants and merchants into the fort, where I saw Major Lloyd very heavy-eyed and little notice taken of him. About 5 in the evening, the inhabitants and servants were imprisoned in storehouses, excepting some few that were left in their own houses. He later became an admiralty judge and was a strong advocate for judicial reform in Newfoundland. In 1750, the British government gave Newfoundland justices the right to hear all criminal cases except treason. Keane became the first commissioner of oyer and terminer, which means to hear and determine, giving him the power to judge such cases. He was a very wealthy landowner and owned property on the waterfront in St. John's, Bonavista, and Greens Pond. Some of the information I got for this presentation is from the Greens Pond Historical Society. When looking at the story, I found it hard to keep the Williams and the Keane family straight. Here is a visual to sort out the Williams Keane. William Keane, the father of the victim, was born in 1658. Our victim was born in 1686. His son William was born in 1715 and returned to England in 1760 after his father's murder. He was said not to like Newfoundland and had none of his father's civic mindedness. His son was born in 1745 and later defied his father to marry against his father's wishes. But that's another story. We have spoken of the victim. Now let's look at the accused. Who stands accused? There were 10 involved in the crime. Matthew Halloran, Nicholas Tobin, John Moody, Edmund McGuire, a soldier with an apparent grudge against the magistrate, Paul MacDonald, Lawrence Lambley, John Munshall, Dennis Hawkins, Robert Power, husband of Eleanor, and Eleanor Power, who was a charwoman, or a maid of all work, to Keane, who lived in Blackhead Village near Cape Spear. In any crime, there's a victim, there's the accused, and of course the motive. So, what was the motive? Money, 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 or revenge, revenge, revenge? Keane was known as a magistrate who was not lenient in his sentencing. Before he became magistrate, he had sent a man who had stolen from him back to England on his own ship to stand trial. He was especially hard on the military accused, often incarcerating the men without consulting their commanding officers. He was wealthy, and Eleanor, his maid, had told the others she had seen a chest of gold under his bed. Edmund McGuire, who had been sentenced to jail and deportation that summer for assaulting a constable, may have held a grudge. The accused were all Irish soldiers and fishermen. There was a general dislike and distrust of Irish in Newfoundland. They were thought to be shiftless and indolent. The timeline. How did it all play out? Late August, the group planned to rob Keene and met at King's Wharf, opposite today's war memorial. They went to the magistrate's house, but there were fishermen splitting fish in the stage next door to the property well after midnight, and they had to abort their plan. September 9th. They met again just before midnight near the magistrate's house. Tobin was posted outside with a musket on Squarey's property. Robert Power was stationed at the corner of Whalen's house. Dennis Hawkins was on the road near the magistrate's house. Paul MacDonald was at the door. Eleanor Power, dressed as a man, McGuire, Lambley, Halloran, Moody, Munshaw, all went inside. They went in, took a chest, drug it out, opened it, and instead of gold, found Keene's best brandy. Angered at no gold, they went in again, but this time Eleanor did not accompany them. When they tried to take the other chest from under his bed, they woke the magistrate, who called out, "Thieves! Thieves! I'm being robbed!" Magistrate Keene was then struck on the head with a broken scythe blade that they had used to break open the lock on the door, and the butt end of a musket. They then stole some money and silver plate. The magistrate died 3 weeks later. He was attended to by Thomas Allen, surgeon, who later gave evidence at his murder trial. The magistrate died 3 weeks later of his injuries. It is now murder, a capital offense, which just a few years earlier, they would have been sent to England for trial. The trial was held at a court of Oyer and Terminer of Newfoundland. There were no lawyers, no defense, and the jury deliberated for only 30 minutes. Nicholas Tobin, one of the accused, turned on the group and testified against them to secure leniency for himself. After the trial, the sheriff ordered gallows to be built. Gallows were also built in other public places as a deterrent for future crimes. Gallows were erected at the foot of Prescott Road on Magistrate Keene's Wharf, and the four were executed. Edmund McGuire and Matthew Halloran on October 10, 1754. They were later gibbeted. Gibbeted means the criminal's body was hung in a cage to rot and as a public deterrent. Eleanor Power and her husband Robert Power hung October 11, 1754, back to back. They were later buried near the gallows, possibly under the Royal Trust Building, which is now the Fortis Building. The rest of the accused, after a short imprisonment, were pardoned by the governor and banished from Newfoundland, never to return. To me, there are still a lot of questions. Why was it so important that Eleanor be executed? Especially after she left before the actual murder. It was also very important that they mentioned in the records that I found the fact that she was dressed as a man during the commission of the crimes. Why were the others just banished and not executed? Was the group really behind it all? Did William's son want control of his father's fortune? They say follow the money. Who stood to benefit from the magistrate's death? For more information, you can find these books and documents at the A.C. Hunter Library or as digitized documents in the Digital Archives Initiative of the Center for Newfoundland Studies at Memorial University. Thanks for listening.